hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. Yeah, Jesus. My hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. Yeah. You deserve it. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah.
It belongs to you. It belongs
to you.
Come on, let's repeat that, church. Come on, say my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Offer up your worship on this morning. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
There we go. Come on, open up your mouth and say you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Everybody say you deserve it.
You deserve it.
From the bottom of my heart, Lord,
you deserve it.
Come on, I say all of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory, yeah.
All of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory, all of the honor, it belongs to you, Jesus.
All of the glory belongs.
Come on, lift those hands. Come on and say, all of the glory belongs to you.
All of the
glory is not for anyone else. He deserves the glory. He deserves the honor. This is why you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Yes, you do, Jesus.
You deserve it.
You deserve it, Lord.
You deserve it.
You deserve it. Say hallelujah,
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 hallelujah. Say
all the glory,
all the honor,
all the praise.
You deserve it.
You deserve it.
Yeah, yeah.
You deserve it.
You deserve it, Jesus.
You deserve it.
Yeah, 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 yeah. You
deserve it.
Praise is when we give thanks. Worship is when we
you
tell you who you are.
It.
You deserve it.
Deserve
you deserve it. You deserve it, Jesus.
Deserve it.
Come on and lift up those hands if he deserves it.
Good evening. Welcome to another Wednesday in the Word. I pray that you and your family are well, that you are blessed, that you are experiencing all of the love, the joy, the grace, the peace, the healing, the love of God our Father. Listen, God is great, and He is greatly to be praised. I am so excited that we can come into your homes on this another Wednesday evening to declare the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am so grateful to God that God has blessed us to come into this holy of holy seasons, where we get an opportunity to change and leave the season of Lent and come into the new season of, the liturgical calendar calls it Easter, we call it resurrection. I'm jumping ahead of myself, but it's such a wonderful week that we could praise God for our Savior, for all that He has done, so that you and I might have eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen, but I'm getting excited on tonight. Listen, I want you to get your Bibles, get your notepads, get your smart devices, and we're going to go into the Word of the Lord in just a few moments. I want to breathe a word of prayer and ask God's blessings on our time. Will you bow with me? God, our Father, how we love you tonight, and we thank you for this another day you have allowed us to see. We know that it is in you that we live, we move, and have our very being. We just praise your holy and your righteous name. Now, Father, as we come into your presence tonight, I pray, God, for my brothers and my sisters. God, you know their requests, you know their concerns, you know their needs. So right now, I lift them up before you, dear God. I pray tonight, dear Lord, as we just praise you and worship your name, that you will forgive us of every one of our sins in thought, word, or deed, that you will blot them out and remember them no more. Now, Father, as we prepare to open up our word, I pray that you will speak to us and speak through us. God, help us to retain what it is that we learned tonight and help us to apply it to our lives so that we could be the better sons and daughters of God. Now, I pray your blessings on us tonight. Do what you must do to get glory, and we thank you in advance in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank God and amen, amen, amen. All right. So, last week, I gave you some homework. I want to know how many of you took time to do the homework. Come on, don't play with me. Last week, we wanted you to find or read, as you read your Bibles, stories where you could see how the details of God, how God instructed his sons and daughters in different areas, making sure that they followed what he said, his instructions, to completion. I don't know, maybe some of you looked at the details of maybe, you know, the things that were in the Ark of the Covenant. Maybe you looked at that. Maybe you looked at how the Ark of the Covenant, you know, only certain people could carry it. Did you look at that? Maybe you looked at the details that were in the synagogue, the temple, and the sanctuary, how certain things had to go in certain places. I don't know. Maybe you looked at the priestly robes and how certain things, I don't know. But whatever it was, there are so many different specifics, things that God said. Maybe you looked and how God said, listen, I'm going to give y'all bread to eat for 6 days, and then you make sure you get enough for the seventh day so you don't have to go get extra bread. Did you? Whatever it is, I hope that you were able to see how when God shares information, as God gives instructions, it is so important for us to follow the instructions that the Lord gives. Amen? So as we follow those instructions, we obey. And as we obey God, obedience leads to blessings. I think I'll say that one more time because that's something you need to put in the chat. Obedience leads to blessings. I tell my children all the time, you can't expect to get the blessings if you did not obey the things that I've asked you to do. Many of us, we want the blessings of God. So that means you and I have to obey what God instructs us. Can you say amen? Let me tell you why that's important, and then I'll be on the road. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. Very important. I need to make sure you underline this, highlight it, put a circle around it, do something. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. Here's what the word says. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. Here it is. For instruction in righteousness. Here's why. That the man of God, the woman of God, may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Can you say amen? So here's what that means in a nutshell. It means that when you and I open the Word of God, the Scripture, we understand that all Scripture is inspired. It is God-breathed. It is the word theonoustros. It is God-breathed. It's like God breathed on the Word, and it's profitable for us. And you and I have got to understand that God sends His Word to correct us, you know, to make sure that we're in line. He sends His Word to instruct us, to teach us in the way that we should go. And as we do this, it makes us complete. Here it is. And that we are equipped for every good work God has assigned for us to do. So that's why it's important that we don't remember our thought. We read the word. What does it say? We understand the word. What does it mean? And then we apply it. What is God saying to me? So that way, when we read God's word, we're reading it, we're getting an understanding, and then we're living it out. We are equipped with the word of God. Amen. Okay, that's a whole nother sermon. Okay, so here we are. We're in this season now, the liturgical calendar, I mentioned it, of Lent. And Lent leads us into the next season. And over this next few days, Lord willing, and we'll come to this coming Sunday. This Sunday moves us from that calendar of Lent to Easter. Easter is the season of resurrection. Okay, the liturgical calendar once again says Easter, and I shared with you all on Sunday. We understand because we know we understand that it's a season of resurrection. We don't trip if somebody says Happy Easter and all of that. We say praise God, you know, Happy Easter, whatever. You know, at our church, you know, we learned that it is a season of resurrection. Resurrection means new life. It means new birth. You get to share that with them, okay? So you and I, here it is, if I could say it prophetically, are coming into a new season. Wow. The season that you've been in, the season of hardship, the season of loneliness, the season of brokenness, the season of disappointment, that season is ending, and now we're coming into a season of new life, of resurrection power. And as we do that, we can believe God for better health. Amen. For the blessings of God. We believe God for this and so much more. So that should be your confession. You should confess, I'm coming into a new season. Amen. And that new season is a season of life. All right. Are you with me? Okay, great. So tonight, I want to talk about and I want to look at an interesting person, a biblical account of a guy by the name of Barabbas. Yeah, we're going to talk a little bit about a guy by the name of Barabbas. All right. We're going to look at two gospels. We talked about the synoptic gospels. We're going to read one and then we're going to kind of unpack another one. All right. But it's going to be for your hearing as we read the word, but I want you to kind of look at them as you go through it during the week and see how God speaks to you. All right, so we're going to talk about Barabbas. Now understand this about Barabbas. When we look at these accounts, and these accounts are going to be, we'll look at Matthew chapter 27, and then we will go over to St. Luke chapter 23. All right, but as we lead up to that, some of the things that we need to know. We understand that this is the time when Jesus was on his way to the cross. Jesus had already been betrayed and arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane. He had already been betrayed by Judas. He was arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane. Peter had already denied him. He had already gone before, you know, the council of elders and scribes. You know, he'd already done all of that. He had already stood trial when you read it before Pilate. And as he stood trial before Pilate, he was found that he actually was under the jurisdiction of Herod. So he was then sent over to Herod. And after Herod, did his time of, if you will, interviewing Jesus, the Bible says that they mocked him and they ridiculed him. And then Herod sent him back to Pilate. I thought it was very interesting in reading that because Herod and Pilate, those guys were enemies. They were enemies. They weren't on the same page. But after coming into the presence of Jesus, Jesus was on his way to the cross. After coming into the presence of Jesus, the Bible says that these two enemies became friends. Let me give you this scripture first, and then we'll go. Luke chapter 23, verse number 12. Luke chapter 23, verse number 12. This is going to bless about 20 of y'all. Listen, here's what it says. That very day, Pilate and Herod became friends with each other, for previously they had been at enmity with each other. Can you say amen? Here's what that means, child of God. It's interesting that they're, you know, kind of standing before the people and they're trying to condemn Jesus, and Pilate is sending them to Herod. Herod sending them back to Pilate. And these two guys who didn't get along, it's interesting, because of the presence of Jesus, that now these enemies have become friends. Here's what's going to help somebody. I thought about it. Could that be a testimony for some of you? Some of you probably, and I know you don't want nobody to know, but there's some folk that have been in church that you said, that ain't, no, I knew them before they came to church. That is not my friend. We used to go at it. We weren't friends in the world. And now that you come into relationship with Jesus, now that God has sent Christ into your life, isn't it interesting that now you can become friends with your former enemies? I'm telling you, that's simply based on the presence of the Lord. Okay, but I got excited about that. But it's interesting about that. So Jesus goes through all of this stuff. These guys who were enemies become friends, and now they're at a place where they're dealing with this guy by the name of Barabbas. Let's look at two synoptic gospels. Synoptic, remember, S-Y-N, synonym. It is the word to see. It means the same, S-Y-N. Something that is very similar. And optic is to see. So here it is. We're going to get the same account from two different, you know, views. You might watch ABC. Somebody else might watch CBS or NBC, but you're going to get the same news story, but you're going to get a little twist on it. All right, let's go to Matthew. Matthew chapter 27, and let's begin reading at verse 15. Now, as you read, highlight the things you need to highlight, underline or put a circle around the things that you want to put a circle around, and let's see how God speaks. Here we go. Matthew 27, beginning at verse 15. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to releasing to the multitude one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that they had handed him over because of envy. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent to him saying, "Have nothing to do with this just man, for I have suffered many things today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitudes that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" They said, "Barabbas." Verse 22. Jesus said to them, "What then shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said to him, "Let him be crucified." Then the governor said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they cried out all the more, saying, "Let him be crucified." When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, but rather had a tumult was rising, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, "I am innocent of the blood of this just person. You see to it." Verse 25. And all the people answered and said, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Can you say amen? I want to look at the same account. I want you to go over to Luke's gospel, St. Luke chapter number 23, and I want you to jump down to verse number 13. St. Luke chapter 23, beginning at verse number 13. The same account, but maybe getting a little different twist on it. Here we go.
Luke chapter 23, verse 13. Then Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, said to them, "You have brought this man to me as one who misleads the people. And indeed, having examined him in your presence, I have found no fault in this man concerning those things of which you accuse him. No, neither did Herod, for I sent you back to him, and indeed nothing deserving of death has been done by him. I will therefore chastise him and release him, for it was necessary for him to release one to them at the feast." And they all cried out at once, saying, "Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas." Who had been thrown into prison for a certain rebellion made in the city and for murder. Pilate, therefore, wishing to release Jesus again, called out to them. But they shouted, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Then he said to them the third time, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found no reason for death in him. I will therefore chastise him and let him go." But they were insistent, demanding with loud voices that he be crucified. And the voices of these men and of the chief priests prevailed. So Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they requested. And he released to them the one they requested, who for rebellion and murder had been thrown into prison, but he delivered Jesus to their will. Can you say amen to that? Let's kind of walk through this a little bit. We want to unpack a little bit of St. Luke's gospel. Now, when we look at this, I want you to kind of, as you kind of in your own personal time, kind of look at both Matthew and Luke's gospel. But let's just kind of unpack it a little bit. Is that all right? All right. So we see that in verse 13 of St. Luke, that, you know, Pilate called the chief priest together and he said, "You brought this innocent man to me. I've examined him and I find no fault to him." And then he says in verse 15 that Herod didn't find anything, and I've sent him back to you, and indeed nothing deserving of death did Jesus do, all right? So here it is. Pilate says in verse 16, and I'm chrysorizing all of this, he says, "I'm going to chastise him, and then I'm going to release him, for it was necessary for him to release one person at the feast." Okay, let's stop right there for a moment. It was necessary, or it was a long time standing tradition, if you will. It was a custom, and this custom was honored by the Romans. And the Romans would release a prisoner during the season or the feast of Passover. Let me give you a scripture. John chapter 18, verse 39. St. John chapter 18, verse 39. Here's what the word says. "But you have a custom that I should release someone to you at the Passover. Do you therefore want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" Can you say amen? So here it is. Here it is that this custom was taking place at this feast. Pilate actually wanted to release Jesus after finding him innocent. He had been innocent of all of the charges that were brought before him. And when Pilate brought this crowd together, he brought them together so it was like so that they could hear him declare the verdict. He was going to tell everybody, you know, that they didn't have social media where it would go out on Instagram. It's not going to go on Facebook. They didn't have eyewitness news right there or breaking news. No, Pilate says, "Everybody come. I'm going to declare him innocent and I'm going to release him because neither myself nor Herod have found any wrongdoings from him." But of course, The people, you know, they didn't want that. So Pilate then says, okay, I'll chastise him. That's what the word uses. That chastise says that he would do. And then one translation says that he would scourge him. And that scourging, he was doing that, listen, to try to pacify those Jews. He was trying to pacify those Jewish leaders who wanted him to be crucified. And he thought that scourging Jesus, you know, scourging was a very harsh and cruel type of punishment. Scourging was not only whipping, but it was a whip with a lash in it. It was like having a whip, and at the end of the whips having kind of hooks in it, and when they whip, it would rip the flesh out. So it wouldn't just be a whelp mark, but it would be a whelp with a rip. He says, I'll scourge him, and this severe punishment, he thought that would pacify all of those who wanted to see harm come to Jesus. But the crowd, that wasn't good enough for them. They wanted Jesus to die. Look at what verse 18 says. The verse 18 of St. Luke says, and they all cried out at once, saying, away with this man, and release to us Barabbas. Stop right there. Okay. After Pilate set the table, he's innocent. I'm about to let him go. All right, I'll scourge him. I'll pacify y'all, thinking that'll work. They said, no, that's not good enough. Listen, away with him. Release to us Barabbas. Who is Barabbas? Glad you asked that. The word Barabbas, when we look up Barabbas, the Aramaic meaning of his name is Bar Abba, which literally means, we talked about it a little bit on Sunday, meaning the son of Abba. Abba meaning a father, or listen, Abba meaning daddy. His name means the son of daddy, the son of a father. One translation says his name Baraba. Barabbas means the son of, excuse me, the teacher. So they said, give us the son of daddy, the son of a father, lowercase f, okay? They also, when looking up Barabbas, his name was Jesus Barabbas. Jesus, Yeshua Baraba. So many scholars look at it. It was like, release to us the son of the father. All right, stay with me. Barabbas, when we see this, they're saying, release to us the son of the lowercase f, father. In the New Testament scripture, when we see Barabbas, we understand that Barabbas was this guy who, well, he was an insurrectionist. He was one who maybe led, or he took part in revolting against civil authority. He was one who acted out against established governmental leaders. That's who Barabbas was. This guy whose name means son of the father, son of daddy, his son of a teacher, this guy was one who revolted, who started trouble, who went against governmental authority. They said, release him to us. Barabbas was not only one who did that, but Baraba was also one who was known as a murderer. And text says that Pilate was going to release Jesus, but the people said in verse 18, away with this man, Jesus, Yeshua, away with him, but give us Bar-Abba. We want him. The Bible says in verse number 19, are y'all still with me? That this man was thrown in prison for a certain rebellion made in the city and for murder. Stop right there. Listen at the request of the people. Who do you want? This innocent man, Jesus? Yeshua,
Or do you want Baraba, the man who caused an insurrection against governmental authority, the man who's known as a murderer? Or do you want this righteous man, Jesus? Look at what the Bible says in verse number 20. Pilate, therefore, wishing to release Jesus, again called out to them. So it wasn't just one time. It was more than one time. He's trying to get the people to receive who he wants to release to them, which is Jesus the Christ. Bible says in verse 21, and I'm almost where I need to be, y'all, that they shouted out saying, "Crucify him. Crucify him." Stop right there. These people, scourging Jesus wasn't enough. Whipping him and humiliating him and embarrassing him was not enough. These people wanted Jesus to experience the most disgraceful punishment that the Romans employed. They wanted Jesus to experience crucifixion. Death on a cross. No. Death on the cross in front of everybody. That he would be stripped down, whipped, beaten, hung on a cross. Listen. Because he said he's the Son of God. And these religious folk, these people, would rather have Barabbas instead of Jesus. Are you still with me? Let's keep going. Pilate in his leadership, he tried to kind of say, listen, are y'all sure? Matthew talks about how Pilate's wife, she said, I can't even take a good nap. I can't even rest. You better leave this innocent man alone. Let him go. Don't be fooling with these people, Pilate. I can't take a beauty nap because God is disturbing my dream, and you need to let this man go. She didn't say it exactly like that, but y'all know I'm chrysalizing it, all right? Now watch what happened. Back in Luke, the Bible says that Pilate then tells the people a third time. Why? What evil has he done? I have found no reason for death in him. I will therefore chastise him and let him go. Pilate, once again, trying to pacify the crowd, trying to offer a harsh, painful punishment without crucifixion. Pilate, not wanting to risk losing his position, however, he compromised with the people. He knew that he was an innocent man, but so that he didn't lose his job and so he could save face with those people, Pilate gave in to their request. Look at what the Bible says in verse 23. But they were insistent, demanding with loud voices that he is Jesus, be crucified. And the voices of these men and of the chief priests prevailed. Stop right there. Pilate did not want to incur another riot. He didn't want anything to kind of go crazy. So he gave in to their requests. Bible says that Pilate sentenced as they requested. Verse 25 says, here's where I want to get to. And I want to get begin to land this plane. And he released to them the one they requested, who for rebellion and murder had been thrown into prison. But he delivered Jesus to their will. Stop right there. Here we go, y'all. Pilate's response lets us know that he gave in to the wrong people's request. He gave in to the request of the people as opposed to doing what was right. Let's stop right here for a moment.
Can I tell you something, child of God? When we look at Pilate being a political figure, if you will, and Pilate gave into the request even though he knew it was wrong. Child of God, many of us, we may not be in the field of politics, but you and I at some point may be challenged with what some call peer pressure. Peer pressure, it happens every day. Peer pressure, work pressure, financial pressure, or church pressure, where something or someone around us will try and maybe pressure us into making a decision, listen, that we know is a wrong decision. And instead of obeying and following the laws of the land, the guidelines, and instead of obeying what God is speaking to us, and instead of listening to wise counsel, Pilate gave in to the crowd. Child of God, if you are here and you find yourself and say, listen, Pastor Chris, man, that's right up my alley because people are trying to get me to do stuff that I know I shouldn't do. I know I shouldn't do this. I know I shouldn't do that. I should not go here. I should not go there. But because they're in my ear, and because I want to be cool with everybody, I want everybody to like me, you know, I'll just give in. I'll try to make it seem one way over here to pacify them. But if that doesn't happen, I'll eventually give in. Ma'am, sir, may I encourage you right now that I and you should rather obey God than to obey men. I said that too fast. Let me say it one more time. As sons and daughters of God, whatever peer pressure, whatever you may be faced with, whether it's something that may, you know, deal with you, some addiction can become addictive. Whether it's drugs or alcohol, don't give in to peer pressure. Maybe somebody else, it may be getting involved in some sexual perversion of some sort or some activity. Don't give in to peer pressure. Maybe it be me, for some young folks, bullying somebody or treating somebody the wrong way. Don't give in to peer pressure. Even if it's around the saints of God, and you know how some folk are, they don't want you to talk to somebody else. That's a whole nother sermon. Don't give in to peer pressure. That's what Pilate did. And Pilate, listen, released Barabbas. And Jesus was sentenced to be crucified. Are you with me? Here's what I want you to do. I want you to put on your thinking caps. Let's buckle up for one moment. When we think about Barabbas being released, what does that mean to you? Put on your spiritual cap for a moment. What does that mean? Barabbas being released and Jesus being sentenced to death. Here we go. When Barabbas was released, could it be fair for us to think, and this is just me thinking, could it be fair for us to think that same spirit was released? Well, Pastor Chris, what spirit are you talking about was released? Could it be that when we look at the times in which we live, and when we have seen, when we have experienced, when we have heard of how insurrectionists and people have acted out against governmental authority? Could that be what's been released? That spirit of Barabbas, when people are coming against government and authority and leaders. We know what the Bible says in Romans chapter 13 about no one is in authority except God has ordained them. But could it be that spirit where people are coming against governmental authorities? That spirit, the same stuff that Barabbas did. Could it be another thing? Could it be when we see so much murder in the land? We just saw something up in Sacramento, California, and then there was something in Iowa where people are shooting up and just murdering and just doing all kind of stuff. When we see these murders taking place, could that be who the people requested? Give us Barabbas. Give us this spirit of Barabbas, where we're going against governmental authority, where we're murdering innocent people. He was already in jail, but we want that. We want you to release that to us and kill an innocent man. Could that be? Could that be? I know people don't mention it too often now, where prayers were taken out of schools, prayers taken out of home. People don't want you to mention the name of Jesus, and you can't say that you're a Christian and a follower of Christ. That not, could that be? We want to put Jesus, the righteous one, aside, but it's okay for us to say all these other things. That's just a thought. And that's what the people wanted. They wanted Barabbas. But then I want you to take that hat off and put on another hat, because this is where all of us line up under the hat or the umbrella of Barabbas. Barabbas was one who sinned. Barabbas was one who caused a rebellion. Barabbas was one that did all of these things. But on the other side is Jesus, taking the place of Barabbas and dying for all of our sins. Doesn't that sound like God? When we blew it, because all of us have sinned, all of us have messed up. But I'm so glad that God sent Jesus to die in my place, to die in your place. Just like in the scripture, it's like Jesus took the place of Barabbas. Barabbas was the one who should have been on that cross, but Jesus died for Barabbas. Jesus died for you and me. And child of God, we may not have been one going against governmental authorities and trying to do all this. That maybe we didn't do that, but we've done something. And tonight, as we come out of this season of Lent, Lord willing, and go into the season of resurrection, I want us to just take a moment and to thank God for Jesus taking our place. He, instead of Barabbas, son of the lowercase F father, lowercase D daddy, God sent his only begotten son to die for our sins. Ma'am, sir, tonight, I want you to know something. Jesus took your place. If you have never come to know him, if you've not asked him to come into your heart and be your Lord and Savior, can I tell you something? If you can have the faith, if you can confess him with your mouth, if you will ask him to forgive you of your sins, can I tell you something? He will forgive you of your sins, because Jesus died for all of our sins. But you've got to be willing to accept the gift. God, I want Yeshua, Jesus, and as opposed to wanting you, wanting Barabbas. I don't want Barabbas. I want the real Jesus. I want the son of the capital F father. I want that Jesus. If you want Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, tonight there's going to be a number that says text prayer. I need you to text that number right where you are. And there's some men and women of God, we want to pray with you and pray for you. You say, I'm already a born again believer. I want you tonight. We're going to, but you're a born again believer, but you need prayer. Text that number. I need you to text that number. We want to pray with you and pray for you. Listen, I want you to do something tonight as we are preparing to close out our time. I want you to just think in this time, these next few days, Lord willing, and as we can see certain things that have been released, when we look at Barabbas, the spirit of insurrection and violence and going against authority, because let me tell you something, that spirit to me is not just going against the authority of government. People go against the authority of government because they've gone against the authorities in homes. Children are disobedient and honorary against parents. When they don't want to be told anything, they don't want to be taught anything. They want to do it their way. They want to have the Burger King mentality. Have it your way. Well, you can't always do that. I want to pray. I want you to be in prayer this week, praying for things that are going on in our land, murders and killings and things that we know that are not pleasing to God. I want us to pray because, listen, Lent, after loneliness, after brokenness, after death, comes resurrection. And resurrection brings new life. And I believe that that life can only come through Christ Jesus. Text that number. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this time, dear Lord, as we have gone through the scripture, God, and just looked at Barabbas and looked at Jesus, Father. And we look at Pilate and how Pilate gave into the people. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us when we have given into the words, the pressure of other people. Forgive us, dear Lord, when we did not obey your word, when we did not obey what you were leading us to do and to say. But God, we wanted to be accepted by people. Forgive us, Father. Forgive us, dear Lord, when we, God, chose to want a Barabbas as opposed to wanting a Jesus. Forgive us. I pray tonight, dear Lord, for those sons and daughters who have not come to know you, that God, tonight you will challenge their heart and that they will give their lives to you. Thank you, dear God, that you will draw them because you love them. I pray, God, that you will encourage my brother, encourage my sister. Bless us tonight to be a blessing to others. I pray, dear Lord, over these next few days as we, God, continue in this holy of holiest weeks, dear God, that we will be mindful of all that Jesus did for us in dying and suffering and bleeding on that cross, God, so that we might have a right to the tree of life. Thank you that he didn't just die, but thank you that he rose again. So we praise your holy and righteous name. Now, Father, there's so much more to pray for. We pray, God, for those that are sick in their bodies, that you will let your healing virtue flow. We pray, God, for those that need direction, that you will lead and guide and order steps. For those that have need, God, thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh, the Lord, our provider. Thank you that you will meet the needs in your sons and daughters' lives. Now, Father, we just love you tonight and we praise your holy and righteous name. We continue to pray for the things going on around the world. We continue to pray that you will have mercy on Ukraine. Look on that land and that nation. We pray, God, that souls will come to know you before it's everlasting too late. We pray for President Putin. We pray for President Biden. We pray for all those that are in authority, God, that there may be peace in our land. Father, the word tells us, God, that the king's heart is in the hands of the master, is in your hands. So, Father, you know how to massage his heart. You know how to lead him, God, so that they will make wise decisions. Have mercy on us tonight. Now, Father, we pray for those that have lost loved ones, that you will continue to comfort and strengthen and bless them, God, even during this time. Now, Father, there's so much more to pray. I just pray your blessings over these, your sons and daughters. Watch over us, cover us, and keep us. God, give us health and strength, God, so that we can praise your holy and righteous name. Now, Lord, the things that we have failed to ask, I pray you grant, because, Father, you know what we have need of, and I give you thanks for this and so much more. In Jesus Christ our Lord, thank God, and amen and amen. All right, that's our time for tonight. I pray that you were blessed. So we look at different passages of scripture. Sometimes we'll see a little different, way that things are being said, but we'll see the same foundation of the same story. Question that I think is interesting in Matthew that was not asked in Luke is, what shall we do with Jesus who is called Christ? I think that's a question that many people are asking. What do we do with Jesus? I think we want to let the world know what we do with Jesus is we live for him. We accept him. We praise him. We love him. We adore him. And that they should come to know and love and accept him just as we. Amen. All right. So that's our time. Listen, our announcing clerk is going to lead us in just a few moments. I want to encourage you. Over these next few days, those who can and will, I want to encourage you, just kind of came on my heart, to encourage you to exercise. Yeah, you didn't know. I knew that was a curveball. Thought I was going to say something else. Huh? I want you to get out and exercise. You know, one of the things that we've got to do is take care of our temples. And yes, I know we're still in the time of pandemic. Wear your mask. For those who can, exercise, go for a little walk, do your stretches. If you've got to go, to the mall, walk around the mall. Don't just walk into a store, but walk around to some of our seniors, you know, in a safe environment, wherever that may be, wherever you're outside, go to a park, get your exercise. I encourage you because I know, you know, some we've gone through some challenges and we're praying for some that said their blood pressure was a little high and all of that. We want to make sure we take care of our temples. Amen. So let's eat right. Cut down on the fried foods. Yeah, I know I said that. Cut down on the fried foods and all that. Let's try to cut back on a little bit. You ain't got to eat fried chicken that many times a week. Amen. So let's take care of our temples. Eat right. Let's exercise. Let's try to get us some rest. I'm preaching to me. Amen. And I believe so that, you know, we can ask God to continue to touch us, give us strength. Let's eat some fruits and vegetables and take care of our bodies. Amen. Wonderful. I want to invite and encourage everybody that can and will. Sunday school is so important. Our children's church, we have these ministries available for children. Listen, we want to minister to the whole family. So we want to encourage you. Our teachers are available, children's church and Sunday school. We're working on new classes for our Sunday school. And Lord willing, very soon we're going to have, you know, some new classes in place so that we could continue to grow as we walk in our Christian faith and on this Christian journey. Amen. Praise God. We got MAP conference. All that stuff is coming up. Our announcing clerk is going to lead us. And then I want to thank you once in advance and once again for your liberality as you continue to be a blessing to the work of the Lord right here at Second Baptist Church. So that's my time. Know that I love you with the love of the Lord, and there ain't a thing you could do about it. If the Lord should tarry his coming and the creek don't rise, I look forward to seeing you this coming Sunday morning, where we will be lifting up the name of our resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ. In the meantime, stay safe, and we'll see you then. Have a good evening.
Join us for Resurrection Sunday, April 17th, 2022, in person or on YouTube at 10 a.m. Masks are required.
Are you a high school senior ready to go off the college but could use some financial help? Or are you a continuing education student with a 2.0 or higher GPA and could use a scholarship? If so, you have until May 17th. 2022 to apply for your D.C. Bailey or the Bishop William McGrew's Large Continuing Education Scholarship. See the flyer or sbcmonrovia.org website for more details.
Which group are you going to be a part of on Monday at 6:30? Man Talk Mondays, The Measure of a Man, or Woman Evolve with the United Women's Fellowship Guild? See the links in the post.
And those are your announcements for this week.